Hey gang, so I'm back and I've had more coffee now, so I won't be quite so slow and droopy. And maybe these videos can continue to be short. I had mentioned last time that we're gonna create this overlay class. And we're gonna pass the same start button into both overlay classes. And what that start button's gonna do is initialize our game for us. But we can pass it to the game over screen and the start screen because we want to start the game in either case. And I mentioned there's this thing called create button we can call. Now, there is this whole class of stuff in P5 that is called the DOM. And I mentioned earlier or in another video that when we look at our website, if we look at our elements, we can see everything that's on our web page, and we can see there's this thing called a canvas that's actually in our HTML. That thing that's in our HTML is not in our HTML. It's one of those miraculous things about life. It is not there, and it is there. It is not there, and it is there, and that's what JavaScript does. JavaScript, our JavaScript in our sketch, we call create canvas. And we put that canvas element in. All of those different create functions are part of the DOM library. And so create canvas isn't actually part of the DOM library. Create canvas is necessary to every single P5 sketch. It's somewhere in here in environment, I think, or I'm not sure where it is. It's a core part of the P5 library. These other things are part of a library called DOM, .p5.dom, which was devoted to DOM manipulation, document object model manipulation. And here it is, p5.dom.min.js. I'm getting an error because I am not importing that into my sketch. I is not defined because if you look at my index.html, although I have the DOM and the sound libraries, I haven't included them in here. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to say script source. And you, if you're using the scaffold, I will have updated it so that you won't have to do this. But I just thought I'd mention it in case you end up in a situation like this. And that way you can understand what needs to happen next. Those both need to be after the core P5 library because they rely on it. So now if I refresh it, you can see there's my button. And if we look at our elements, there's my button. Now we can give that button, we can create an event listener that's going to listen for a click. And what's neat is if we look at a create button, we can see we can say dot mouse pressed and then pass a function. So where before we were creating, we can also create these event listeners in the traditional JavaScript-y way, but let's just do it in the P5-y way. So we'll say mouse pressed and we'll pass in a function. We'll say this dot start button. So we're going to call this.init. Now, here I want to mention a nifty little thing about arrow functions. And one reason I favor them generally is this is not written like an arrow function. And what I'm going to do is click on it. And let's just see what happens. OK, so we don't get anything. So let's just say console. Log. Hi. Oh. Okay, so that's working just fine. Sometimes what can happen is the NP5 must be handling this in a really nice, nifty way. Sometimes what can happen is that our this is no longer defined. We can see. Let's actually console.log this and see where we are. see what our scope is. It's a game, and there's all of our game right there. So that's nice. And if we click on it, we see, oh, that's interesting, right? So now are this, before when we initialized it, our this was the game. Now it's the P5 element. So this is actually going to be a problem. This is going to be a problem when it comes to, because the this won't be clear. But if we make this an arrow function, now let's see what the this is. So the this is our game. So that's one thing that's really nice about arrow functions, is they maintain the scope in which they were declared. And if you're confused about that, just holler at me. We can talk about it some more. Okay, so we're not gonna call this dot init here. We're gonna only call it when the button gets pressed. For each game.render. So we've got a problem. Game 33, if we don't call it right away, we see it wants to call this.coin. So what I'm going to do is actually initialize those coins. I'm going to initialize them at the start. And I'm going to reinitialize them. And we could do the same with our hero as well if we want to. But you see there's nothing rendering. Why are we rendering those coins? Oh, did I set the collective false game? We want to render the coins. Why aren't I seeing the coins? I don't know. We'll come back to that. Right now we want to pass this. We don't want to display this start button there. We want to put it inside of our overlay. So let's do that. We'll say for our overlay, we're going to bring in, you saw before when we bring in when we make our overlay, we bring in a text and a text and a text. And let's play Mario. And you can see if I've got the single apostrophe, it's going to get confused. I can use backticks or double quotes to clear that up. Use arrow buttons to move. And I could get more elaborate with that, but game over. Start again. And we could be more elaborate with that, but for now I think I'll just leave it like that. And I'm gonna make our thing now. We're gonna have a text and a start button, because in our overlay now we can just say text one, text two, start button, and we can say this dot text one equals text one. This dot text two equals text two. One. This dot start button. And a nice thing here is we've actually passed this listener in with this button. So we have this button in our home, in our game, and we can update things in our game from this other component. And no matter which component it is, it's going to update our game in the same way, which is kind of nifty. Let's just keep going with this. And we want to get this start button up here in some kind of a box. So let's go ahead and we'll say this. And we could do this in either place, but I'm just gonna do it here. And we're gonna give it a position. Let's see. Now, those aren't going to be the final position of this. Instead, what we're going to do is make a box in here. And, oops, I hate when it does that. There we go. That box is going to be a rectangle, not a reflect, rectangle. And that box is going to be at this. That box is going to be at this very position. And it's going to have a width, overlay width, overlay height. Nice. And I think I might want to calculate that based on the, let's see, we'll call this game settings overlay color. And let's set stroke weight to 0. So we don't have any outlines on these texts. And we'll set the fill. Oh wait, we wanna after. So every time we change, we call invoke fill, we change what color's being drawn with the fill. So I'm gonna use the overlay color, and then I'm just gonna use black. And we'll say text just use that text size, and we'll say text, this dot text one, and we'll need a position. So annoying when it does that. You gotta make sure to correct those if it does that to you. All right, good. Now we're gonna get a couple positions for these, and this is gonna be game settings dot overlay x minus 40. Is that right? Yeah. And this will be game settings. Let's see now. Hold on a sec. Let me think about this. 250, 50, no. This is plus 130. And because we're going to have the box, and then we're going to be over. So there's going to be a box. And before I make these, let's just leave those where they are for now. And what we'll do is take a look at this box. We got to have the overlay color and the overlay X. So let's go to our game settings. And we'll have an overlay color. And it's gonna be pretty much white, but not, but it's gonna be partially transparent. So that fourth value is what's called an alpha value. What else did we need? We need an overlay X. And we need an overlay Y. And so for our overlay X, we'll say 250. And for this one, we'll say 50. So we're going to put it a quarter of the way across the screen and just a little bit down from the top. And you can see now my button's at that position. I'm not seeing the overlay. So where's that overlay? Let's go back to our overlay. And this is going to be actually not that position. It's going to be 250 plus 170, so a little bit farther over, pretty close to halfway. And so we'll put it down there. And there we go. So now it'll be in there. And why aren't we seeing this rect? Oh, because we don't have an overlay width or overlay height. Let's add those. And so now there's again these other variables that we can just change them in here if we decide we want to change the look of this. And I think I've decided I want this button to be a little bit farther over right off the bat. But before I do that, let me show you one more thing. So we can use if the element is in the DOM. Now a lot of this stuff is not using the DOM. It doesn't, this line right here, this rectangle, doesn't ever appear in my elements. But my button does, because I used create button and create canvas. And you can see it's got some style. It's got a position of absolute position, and it's got a left of 420 and a top of 200, which is what this position is giving us. There's 420 and there's 200. But I can also go to my HTML and add some styling to this thing. So what I'm going to do is here, I'll do it up here. I'll say style. And I'm going to say for all my buttons, I want to give it a width of 4 rems. Which is related to the way of specifying a size related to the default font size of my document. And I'm going to give it a border radius of 1.2 rems and a background color of blue. And maybe I'll change that a little bit. And I'm going to give it a color white. So, you know, this is another way to work on websites. You can see there's my button. I don't like this outline, so what I'm going to do is also say border none. And that's not too bad. I need to make this wider. Width is going to be 6 rems. And that's a pretty good start button. I'm going to also give it a hover state. So I'll make another one of these CSS declarations. And give it this colon with hover. Now, I'm not getting too deep into CSS here. And it's not really something that this course is designed to be about. But I just wanted to show you that in case it was of interest. I'm going to make this color black, and I'll make this kind of grayish. So when we hover, it's going to change color. And if you've ever wondered how the internet works, that's how the internet works. Let's move this over another 50 pixels. So I'll go to my overlay. That's a little too far. There we go. So now I've got the start button. I'm not seeing any text yet because I haven't rendered it. And we're going to say this.txt1 game overlay. What was that? That was at 250. 80. This will be, this is text 2. That's going to be game settings dot overlay y plus 100. This will be. This one we want to be on top, and it's going to be plus, let's just say 30 and 50. Oh wait, the X is, that's how far over it is. Let's just take a look. So I need, that needs to go farther over. So this will be 130. That'll be 130, let's say. Hey, not bad. So there's my start screen. And if I push this, nothing happens. Except I do get that console.log. So when I push that, what I want to happen is I want to start the game. And in here, what I'll say is this.game.started equals true. Oh wait, no, just this.started. This.started equals true. Let's see if it starts. Yep. Oh. This.started button.hide. Oh, start button. Boom. Okay, the game started. I'm not seeing the coins or the Mario, but we'll figure that out in the next video. This one's gotten kind of long, and we are getting somewhere. We've got a game started. We're not rendering the start screen or the game over screen. Now we're going to render the hero. That's not why the coins aren't rendering. So there's a problem at coin render. I goofed on those images. We'll fix that in the next video. All right.